Live to the Reserve Bank, where the governor, Lesetse Kganyago, has begun.
While some of the key risks to the rand appear to have subsided for now, they could re-emerge at any stage. Global growth prospects are mixed amid policy uncertainty, primarily in the US and the UK. The domestic growth outlook remains challenging, although a modest improvement is expected over the forecast period. The year-on-year inflation rate, as measured by the Consumer Price Index, for all urban areas measured 6.8% in December, up from 6.6% in November. The December outcome surprised on the upside relative to the bank's forecast and the market consensus expectation of 6.5%. The main sources of this surprise included food prices, housing rentals, recreation and culture, and restaurants and hotels. Food price inflation remained elevated at 12% in December, matching the recent high recorded in October 2016. The contribution of the category of food and non-alcoholic beverages to the overall inflation outcome has remained unchanged at 1.8 percentage points for the past 3 months. Good price inflation measured 7.8% in December, up from 7.7% in November, while services price inflation increased from 5.6% to 5.9%. The bank's measure of core inflation, which excludes food, fuel, and electricity, measured 5.9%, up from 5.7%. Producer price inflation for final manufactured goods measured 6.9% in November, compared with 6.6% in October. The main contributor to the November outcome was the category of food products, beverages, and tobacco products, which contributed 3.9 percentage points. The inflation forecast of the bank has deteriorated since the previous meeting of the MPC. Headline inflation is now expected to only return to within the target range during the final quarter of 2017 and to average 6.2% for the year, compared with 5.8% in the previous forecast. The forecast for 2018 is more or less unchanged at an average of 5.5%. The peak of the forecast remains at 6.6%, which was recorded in the final quarter of 2016, and this level is now expected to persist in the first quarter of 2017. This deterioration is mainly due to changed assumptions regarding international oil prices, the domestic fuel prices, and the outlook for food prices, which more than offset the more favorable exchange rate assumption. By contrast, the forecast for core inflation is unchanged, averaging 5.5% and 5.2% in 2017 and 2018, respectively. Inflation expectations, as reflected in the survey conducted by the Bureau for Economic Research during the fourth quarter of 2016, showed average inflation expectations for 2017 declining from 6% in the third quarter to 5.8%. The same outcome is expected for 2018 as well as for five-year inflation expectations. Despite the slight moderation, expectations remain more or less anchored at the upper end of the target range, but with a narrower divergence between the different groups of respondents than is usually the case. The expectations of these groups ranged from 5.6% to 6% for 2017 and from 5.4% to 6% for 2018. The outcome may have been distorted by the marked decline of 0.6 percentage points for trade union respondents. The median annual inflation expectations of market analysts, as reflected in the Reuters Econometer survey, are relatively unchanged at 5.8% and 5.5% for 2017 and 2018. Bond market expectations implicit in the break-even inflation rate declined across all maturities since the previous meeting, though remaining above the target range. The global economic outlook remains uncertain, despite an increased optimism regarding US growth following the US presidential elections. There is still a great deal of uncertainty regarding the policies of the new administration, particularly with respect to the size of the promised fiscal stimulus. While some of the initial optimism has since been tempered somewhat, US growth is expected to be relatively strong, but with some downside risks posed by a stronger dollar. Uncertainty also persists regarding the prospects for the UK economy, as the terms of the disengagement from the EU are unlikely to be resolved for some time. The steady but slow growth recovery in the Eurozone is expected to continue. But upcoming elections in a number of countries could pose risks to the outlook, alongside ongoing concerns about the prospects for the Italian economy. The outlook for emerging markets is also unclear, given conflicting developments. Commodity prices, especially industrial commodities, have risen in recent months, but protectionist threats from the US, if carried through, could undermine world trade and have an adverse effect on emerging markets in particular. These countries are also highly dependent on Chinese growth, which is expected to remain above the 6% level. However, given the credit-driven nature of the recent Chinese growth, there are fears of an unsustainable credit bubble, which could expose financial sector vulnerabilities and undermine the growth outlook. There are tentative signs of global inflation edging up as fears of deflation recede amid higher energy and food prices. As expected, the US Fed tightened monetary policy in December and signaled further increases to come. However, the pace of increase is still expected to be relatively moderate amid a highly uncertain economic policy environment. Both the ECB and the Bank of Japan have maintained their highly accommodative policy stances. This divergence between the advanced economies is likely to persist for some time. The rand has displayed a degree of resilience since the previous meeting of the MPC, having traded in a relatively narrow range of between 14.22 rand and 13.46 rand against the US dollar. Since the previous meeting, the rand has appreciated by 5.6% against the US dollar and by 4.2% on a trade-weighted basis. The rand was positively impacted by the decisions of the ratings agencies not to downgrade the sovereign foreign credit rating to sub-investment grade, although this remains a risk in the coming months. The limited response of the rand exchange rate to the increase in US policy rate in mid-December suggests that the move had been largely priced in. A gradual pace of tightening is expected in the US, with the rand vulnerable to any upside surprises in this respect. The rand has been positively affected by the improvement in the terms of trade following the recent modest increase in commodity prices. Although the current account deficit is expected to narrow over the forecast period, it remains relatively wide. In line with the recent improved capital flows to emerging economy bond markets, non-residents have been net buyers of South African bonds since the beginning of the year, whilst equity net sales have continued. This follows persistent net sales of both bonds and equities during the last 3 months of 2016. The economic growth outlook remains weak and more or less unchanged since the previous meeting of the MPC. The bank expects growth to have averaged 0.4% in 2016, although recent monthly data for the fourth quarter suggests that there may be a downside risk to this forecast. The forecast for 2017 has been revised down marginally to 1.1% from 1.2% and remains unchanged at 1.6% for 2018. This improved outlook relative to 2016 is consistent with the recent upward trend in the composite leading indicator of the bank. By contrast, the RMB BER Business Confidence Index declined again in the fourth quarter following a recovery in the previous quarter. Much of this decline was driven by the new vehicle sector. The recent monthly data paint a bleak picture for the fourth quarter of 2016. Mining production, which had improved in the second and third quarters, contracted in both October and November. However, improved commodity prices are expected to help the sector in the coming months. The manufacturing sector recorded low but positive growth in November, following a month-to-month decline in October. The Barclays Purchasing Managers Index, PMI, declined further in December and recorded its first consecutive month below the neutral 50 level. The low level of business confidence is reflected in the continued but slower contraction in real gross fixed capital formation. Gross fixed investment has contracted for four consecutive quarters and has been particularly marked in the private sector. This has contributed to the persistent labor market weakness, with formal non-agricultural employment, excluding temporary election-related employment, remaining unchanged in the year to the third quarter of 2016. The official unemployment rate increased to 27.1%, its highest level since the inception of the quarterly labor force survey in 2008. Wage growth appears to be responding to the weak labor market environment. Year-on-year nominal wage growth per worker moderated for a fifth consecutive quarter in the third quarter of 2016, down to 5.8%. Following a small decline in labor productivity growth, nominal unit labor costs in the formal non-agricultural sector increased to 5.7%. The slower nominal wage growth per worker is consistent with the lower wage settlement rate reported by Andrew Levy Employment Publications. Household consumption expenditure data paint a mixed picture. Growth in household consumption expenditure accelerated to 2.6% in the third quarter, despite a further contraction in durable goods consumption. Real retail trade sales declined in October, but increased markedly in November on a month-to-month basis. By contrast, wholesale trade sales contracted in both months. Domestic new vehicle sales remained subdued following further declines in the final quarter of last year. Notwithstanding some improvement, consumers remain under pressure and consumer confidence remains low, as indicated in the sharp contraction in the FNB BER Consumer Confidence Index in the fourth quarter. Households remain highly indebted despite a further moderation in the debt ratio, and the subdued housing and equity markets have contributed to an absence of strong wealth effects. Slower wage growth, along with stagnant employment growth and expected tax increases in the forthcoming budget, are also likely to dampen consumption expenditure. A further constraint to consumption expenditure growth has been the weak credit extension to private sector, which at 4.5% in November was the lowest year-on-year growth since late 2010. While growth in credit extension to the household sector was particularly subdued, that to the corporate sector also moderated in the second half of 2016. The strongest decline was seen in mortgage credit extension for commercial property. Food price inflation is expected to decline following good rainfall in parts of the country. Spot prices for maize and wheat have declined significantly, and a marked higher maize crop is expected this year. However, the impact on prices at the consumer level are yet to be felt, with meat prices likely to lag other food price categories as farmers restock their herds. Although the bank's inflation forecast assumes that food price inflation has more or less peaked, the pace of moderation is expected to be slower than in the previous forecast. Food price inflation is now expected to average 7% during 2017, compared with 6.5% previously. Food price disinflation is expected to be constrained or delayed by higher fuel costs and a rising trend in global food prices. Brent crude oil prices increased by over 20% to almost $60 per barrel in response to the OPEC brokered agreement to restrict production. Prices have since moderated to current levels of around $55 per barrel. The sustainability of this agreement and its longer-term impact on prices is uncertain, given the possibility of offsetting developments. A number of oil producers were exempt from the agreement. There are incentives and scope for cartel members to exceed their quotas, and U.S. shale producers have already increased production in response to higher prices. These factors are likely to constrain oil price increases. While the bank's oil price assumption has been revised up, the trajectory is relatively flat. Despite the stronger rand exchange rate, the domestic price of 93 octane petrol increased by 50 cents per liter in January, and a further increase can be expected in February. The MPC has noted the marked deterioration in the inflation forecast since the previous meeting, as well as the extension of the expected breach of the upper level of the target range by a further 2 quarters. Inflation is now expected to return to within the target range in the final quarter of 2017. While this is a cause for concern, the main drivers of this deterioration are supply side shocks, in particular oil and food prices. The increase in the international oil price is not expected to be a start of a new oil price spiral. Various supply side factors are expected to constrain oil prices going forward in the absence of any major global political risks that would threaten production. While the food price forecast has been adversely affected by higher input costs, a steady decline in food price inflation is still expected. The more favorable rand exchange rate has been an important factor in offsetting some of the negative impacts of these developments. Despite a turbulent second half of 2016, both domestically and globally, the rand has been relatively resilient. Furthermore, the current level of the rand is stronger than that implicit in the forecast, and pass-through to inflation continues to be relatively muted. Nevertheless, it remains vulnerable to both domestic and external shocks. As always, the approach of the committee is to look through the first round effects of exogenous shocks, but remain focused on the possible emergence of second round effects, which could require a policy response. At this stage, the longer term trajectory over the relevant policy horizon is unchanged, as is the forecast for core inflation. In particular, the MPC will take note of possible changes in the longer-term inflation expectations, which have shown tentative signs of moderation in the fourth quarter of 2016. The MPC assesses the risks to the inflation outlook to be moderately on the upside. The domestic growth outlook has remained largely unchanged despite a possible weaker outcome in the fourth quarter of 2016. While some improvement is anticipated over the forecast period, growth is expected to remain below potential. The risks to the growth forecast are assessed to be broadly balanced. Growth prospects remain dependent on uncertain but tentatively improving global conditions and their impact on commodity prices. Domestically, some improvement in agricultural production can be expected. However, a significant improvement in growth prospects requires the implementation of structural reforms which could contribute to increased business and consumer confidence. In light of these developments and the assessment of the balance of risks, the MPC has unanimously decided to keep the repurchase rate unchanged at 7% per annum. The MPC remains focused on the medium to long-term inflation outlook, but the deterioration of the shorter-term outlook requires increased vigilance. Furthermore, the MPC remains concerned that the longer-term inflation trajectory continues to be uncomfortably close to the upper end of the target range. The MPC retains the view that we may be near the end of the hiking cycle. However, should second-round effects emerge that undermine the longer-term inflation outlook, there may be a reassessment of this view. At this stage, let's turn to questions that you might have. And as usual, please identify yourself and the media house that you come from. You are new. Say. You don't know how to switch that. Alain, can you help? There you go.
Oh, okay, there you go. Thank you. I'm Bongeni from SABC. Forgive me if my questions sound a bit uninformed. Like you've said, I'm new. My first question, do you think that the current stance of the Reserve Bank keeping interest rates or maintaining interest rates at current levels is helping in any way to create jobs in the economy and improve employment? If so, how so?
Thank you, Mongeni. Say, in a white shirt.
Afternoon, Governor. I'm Funeko from Reuters News. I just wanted to ask if the current growth levels, the current low growth levels, and the widening current account, is the Reserve Bank worried that it might have to increase its foreign reserves in order to boost liquidity in that context? Thank you.
Ma'am?
Hilary Jaffe from Business Day. Governor, I noticed that your inflation forecast has moved from 5.8% average for this year to 6.2%. So number one, is that one of the largest changes in your forecast that you have made in the last couple of years? And number two, did the committee discuss a hike in interest rates?
Can you repeat the first part of the question?
The first part is that one of the biggest changes you've had to make to your forecast in the last while?
Okay, I leave that with Rashad. I don't think
okay,
so. I think there might have been, there are times when we had bigger revisions.
Okay, but also, yeah, did you discuss, in the light of that, did you discuss increasing interest, the increase rate?
Can we take, you say ladies first, okay.
Afternoon, Governor Kola from Bloomberg News. Two maybe just technical questions. I've noticed you've shortened your forecast period. Could you explain to us why you felt the need to do that, since we don't have 2019 forecasts? And then in the speech, you talk about the peak in inflation remaining at 6.6%, but also that we had inflation in December at 6.8%. Could you just clarify that whole sentence? Where you also say the levels now expected to persist in the first quarter of 2017. So you're saying the peak of inflation will remain at 6.6%, but we're at 6.8% in December, right? Mm-hmm. So is that an average? And what do you? I just don't get that sentence. Thanks.
Say.
Governor Arabile Kumete from Bloomberg News. Just with regards to the things that have sort of happened and transpired ranging from November last year to now even, including then CPI coming in at 6.8%, did the MPC feel a lot more pressure than other MPCs, other meetings rather, to hike rates at any point in time?
Okay. Mbongeni, you're SABC, huh?
Yes.
You are aware that our mandate in terms of the constitution is to protect the value of the rand in the interest of balance and sustainable growth. The constitution says the primary mandate of the Reserve Bank is the protection of the value of the rand. That means we protect the value of the rand in your pocket and what it buys. If your income is fixed and prices continue rising, the value of the rand in your pocket is declining. We are not protecting it. The authors of our constitution, when they said in the interest of balance and sustainable growth, understood that you can't have balance and sustainable growth when you have got runaway prices and runaway inflation. But they also understood that growth have got to be balanced and sustainable. You will see in the statement we spent a lot of time talking about employment trends and what is actually happening to unemployment. So we watch these things. But to the extent that we watch these things, we watch them and what impact they have on our primary mandate, which is the protection of the value of the currency. In terms of the stance itself is actually still accommodative. We are forecasting inflation to average 6.2% in the new year, in 2017, up from 5.8 previously. On a forward-looking basis, the policy rate is at 7%, you are barely having positive real interest rates. So the stance itself is still accommodative. You can take further and say into 2018, you are expecting an average within the target. Even with that average within the target, you will actually realize that the stance is still fairly accommodative. So we had previously spelled out that South Africa was facing this policy dilemma where we had slow growth and rising inflation, and that puts a policy conundrum for a central bank. For you have got a mandate in terms of the constitution to protect the value of the currency in the interest of balanced and sustainable growth, and with growth at those low levels, you can't even quite talk about growth being sustainable. And so in the November meeting, we alluded to the fact that that dilemma might actually be getting alleviated as we were projecting inflation to be coming down and growth beginning to accelerate. The December inflation outcome had made this MPC to look at those figures and then say that, look, we've got to be worried here, because it looks like inflation is rearing its head once again. Which then brings me to Tola's question about the peak of 6.6%. The peak, we are referring to the quarter. So the average for the fourth quarter is 6.6. The 6.8 was a reading for the December month. So that is the difference between those figures. And you also said, why have you shortened our forecast? Our forecast is normally over a 24-month period. That is roughly the policy horizon. It just so happens that we are in January, and the 24 months will give you 24 months that end in December 2018. So as the year goes, we will see when we add the other year, it will still give you roughly 24 months rather than, it's not that it has been shortened, it has not been shortened, it is still 24 months. Mfuneko, growth levels, current account deficit, reserves. Well, growth is low. And for an economy that is growing at such low levels, the current account deficit should be lower, not at the levels that we had seen it. We saw an adjustment that took place last year in terms of the current account deficit. But as we say, over the forecast horizon, we still expect the current account deficit to remain elevated. Should we, you say that, are we going to be buying reserves? We constantly look for an opportunity. When opportunities present themselves and we could accumulate reserves, we do. And last year, we did increase our reserves as we experienced some significant capital inflows. That is just but one risk mitigant. The big mitigant for South Africa with respect to the current account deficit is the fact that we are running a floating exchange rate regime, which then plays a role of a shock absorber when we have got gyrations in the markets, or when we think that, when we see imbalances emerging, both either internally or externally, you see the, an adjustment that comes through the exchange rate, and the exchange rate becoming the shock absorber.
As Reserve Bank Governor Lesetša Ganyago, as expected, no change to interest rates. That was widely expected, but some really interesting rhetoric today. A while back, Lesetša Ganyago basically suggested that unless things changed, the bank was in a position where it could keep rates steady or even start cutting rates in future. But today he was hinting at a possible change. The inflation outlook has deteriorated. Now, of course, you control inflation by raising those rates. So he's not saying the bank is thinking of this yet, but it's a possibility, talking about the risks to inflation, which is something that South Africa has worried about, while other parts of the world are desperate for inflation. And it's all affected by oil prices, the amount we pay for petrol, whatever increases prices in the shops, of course, the value of the rand as well. Then, very interesting, he was talking about the bank's mandate, and the bank used to talk about only targeting inflation, but that's changed considerably, and he was outlining its accommodatory stance, meaning that the bank does look at growth, talking about the rand. So we'll get some analysis shortly. Stay with us. We take a short break. I'll be back with two analysts to unpack what the Reserve Bank Governor was saying this afternoon.
When cell phones get cut off, people say Mdluli was listening. Who are you? We have to approach Dennis Breitenbach, who was the prosecutor by then.
The DA parliamentarian?
That's correct. The one who was making halabaloo about me.
There are allegations here that you abused the slush fund. What do you say to that?
We don't have slush fund. I don't know about slush fund.
I respect the fact that you cannot talk a lot about the Secret Service and all that. I guess that's the norm internationally.
Yeah.
But how do we know that you, Richard Ngluli, are not abusing the funds of the state? You are counted amongst the president's men. Are you?
That is rubbish.
Also the matter of General Boysen in KZN. He's not speaking very well of you.
No, that one is talking rubbish.
You are perceived to be very powerful, General, and, you know, people who don't agree with you seem to pay the price. What is happening with the Oparamkhibe case?
No, I'm surprised because, I've said, I'm a person of people.
Welcome back. The Reserve Bank has kept the repo rate, the benchmark interest rate that it lends out to the main commercial banks, unchanged. That was expected. So that means if you are in debt, if you hold a bond, etc., the prime interest rate stays at 10.5%. But there was a lot of interesting detail around that decision today. And to discuss, I'm joined by Elise Kruger from NKC African Economists and Mamelo Matikinga, and she's from FNB. Thank you so much for joining me. Mamelo, let's start with you, and I'd like a comment from both of you. It sounds like there is a change in tone. We were talking about possible interest rate cuts a while ago. He's hinting that maybe inflation could change things. Do you agree?
100%. I think what was surprising from that statement was that upward revision in inflation to 6.2%. So initially, well, last year at least, the SAB had said to us, look, we think we expect inflation to return within the target in the second quarter. So now they expect inflation to remain above the upper end of the target for a longer period of time. But interestingly, even though the inflation profile is not returning within the target as anticipated or as quickly as initially thought, it does seem as if they're really, really concerned about growth. He highlights that growth is well below potential. Mm. So it does seem as if, you know, even though they're not explicit about it, they are really concerned about economic growth.
Let's come back to that. But your comment on inflation, yeah, he's talking about it only coming within that band of 3 to 6% in the fourth quarter of this year now.
Yes, you know, if you remember correctly, in November last year, the bank has kept a bit of a back door open in the very last sentence of the statement, saying that, you know, they do see the risk to inflation to be moderate to the upside, and if the risks would materialize, they would reconsider the view that they are close to the upper end of the interest rate cycle. And, you know, with the December inflation curveball, I want to call it, it was really a curveball in the sense that, you know, both food inflation surprised to the upside, you know, as well as a few other factors simultaneously resulted in that spike to 6.8. And that has changed the story as the starting point for the inflation forecast has moved quite considerably higher than expected. You know, as a difference between a 6.5 and a 6.8 is quite notably. So that has lifted the whole, you know, curve for looking forward. I'm not surprised to hear that they're going to look through it in the sense that, you know, yes, food inflation is still expected to decline gradually, and they see the longer term view. And, you know, it's heartening to see they stick to that in the sense that, you know, always they tell us they look forward by 12 to 18 months. Lisita even mentioned 24 months today. So, yes, this is a short-term deterioration, and I'm glad that they didn't punish the economy by, say, hiking rates today because of this deterioration in CPI. Because a 0.4 on an annual average is quite a big adjustment for the central bank. But they said, you know, it's a short-term deterioration. Looking forward, they're still comfortable that we will see inflation coming down.
Well, he did suggest what you picked up on at the end was that basically the bank is holding back. It could actually push rates up because of inflation, but it does care about growth. And this is so interesting because I remember for the past few years, a lot of debate around the mandate of the bank. And he was saying we're being accommodatory, really outlining how he sees the mandate. Did you find that interesting?
It was quite interesting, but I think what gives him a level of comfort is that inflation expectations are lowering. So generally people are expecting prices to decline quite well later on this year. And I think as well, he does say that, look, the rand has stabilized and that should offer some support to the inflation outlook. And also remember, SABC is going to release that new inflation basket, so there could be some adjustments there. And I think that the fact that core inflation, their forecast for core inflation hasn't changed, gives them enough justification to say, look, even though inflation is high, we're going to keep rates steady. And of course, not indirectly saying support the economy. They did lower that growth forecast, as I mentioned, to 1.1%.
Elise, do you agree? So no change in stance, really. I mean, the bank used to say we don't target a level of the rand, but he was talking about the rand a lot. How did you see what he was saying?
Yes, I think they are very thankful for a stable rand exchange rate at this point in time. If it wasn't for the rand so strong and so stable over the past few months, I think the whole story would have been, you know, notably different. So yes, the rand is definitely helping on the inflationary side. You know, as we import our products, we pay less for that with a stronger rand. And also the stable rand is quite positive for the economy. I mean, the fact that the rand remains at 13.50 on average compared to maybe a Big Mac indication of, you know, below 6 or something, is still positive for this economy because it helps us on the export side. It helps us on tourism. Mm-hmm. We also, you know, needed growth impetus come from. So I think, you know, if we have a stable rand, that is just as positive, even at these levels, compared to just a strengthening rand.
Mm. That 13.50 level, like you say, maybe we should be grateful given the volatility since the US election. The rand hasn't performed that badly. But he was talking about the threats and Trump. What did you think about what he said?
You know what? I think the uncertainty surrounding the Trump presidency and policies that he's going to implement is a huge risk for the rand. We've seen repeatedly that our rand does take a cue from what happens in the US. And I think if we look at what the market is saying is that essentially expected fiscal stimulus in the US is going to be positive for that economy. But at the same time, the risk is that inflation could increase quite aggressively in the US. And if that happens, the Fed will hike rates more aggressively and we end up where we were last year. So although it has stabilized, we have to wait and see what the implications of the policies that Donald Trump is planning to implement are going to be on the rand.
Is Trump the possible wild card for all our plans?
Definitely so. I think, you know, for the global economy, you know, as a whole, it's a big uncertainty as to what will happen and what will be the impact on the global economy. And also, you know, the ramifications for us. Although our trade with the US is quite small, it's more a question of we're part of the emerging market universe, and if what's happening in the US and the impact on the global, you know, picture is negative for emerging markets, we will also feel that. At NKC, we also expect that, you know, the dollar will strengthen further. We're talking about parity against the euro by the end of this year, you know, and if we're looking at that type of levels, you do look at a weaker rand environment towards the end of the year.
The dollar keeps getting stronger, but Trump himself seems to want a weaker dollar to boost American exports. Does he have any control over that, do you believe?
I don't think any control per se. I mean, he can talk the currency, you know, up or down, or try to talk that. But I think the market positioning, you know, is at the moment already indication that, you know, they do expect the dollar to be stronger in the environment of the policies that Trump talks about, you know, in terms of, you know, high economic growth in the U.S., like you just mentioned, you know, high interest rates, more capital flows to the U.S. will result in a stronger currency. So even if he talks it weaker, if, you know, the rest of his actions result in a stronger dollar, you know, the impact will be felt globally.
Okay, so we're now in a position where the bank in future could go either way, basically. Inflation is what's going to change things. And he was talking about Brent crude oil, the deal that's pushed oil prices up. He said that's a bit uncertain, but I think we know that prices will remain capped. Do you think that's a big factor this year?
Look, I don't think so, because I think our assumptions are relatively more or less in line with what the SAB is saying in terms of the oil price. I think where the big swing factor is, and I think that there was no mention in it in this budget speech, and we'll probably get indication of it probably in the months that are to come, probably next month, is core inflation. That's what I would be worried about. And I think if core inflation does move up higher, there is risk for them to actually tighten interest rates. And I say this because if you look at medical aid costs, currently we have that penciled where we expect a double-digit increase. And from what I'm picking up from the SAB, it seems as if they're not that aggressive. So if that does transpire and you see a core inflation rate that increases or hugs the upper band of the target for a prolonged period of time, and I think in that situation, then we could be looking at possible
interest rate
hikes.
All right, so it sounds like you think that could happen even this year. I'm going to ask you both to give me a possible scenario for this year.
I mean, look, we're looking at interest rates remaining flat for this year and next year. We think the possibility of a rate cut is out of the question. And this is because we are in an interest rate hiking cycle in the U.S. And as we've just discussed, that the risks to the rand, which seems as if it's the one thing that's helping the inflation outlook, if I may put it like that, the risks to that remain quite high. Mm. And I would also just highlight that core inflation, I think, could also be a potential risk. And we'll get more indication of that probably sometime in March.
Okay, let's come back after break. And then I'm going to ask you for your prediction, because we will have a little bit more chatting time. And we can talk about core inflation and food prices. Stay tuned, back after this.
I don't know what's going on. Suddenly, I'm locked up.
This is not fair, Santa Basizan. Not fair.
You put the rent at 200. I've been looking at 200. Uri one, we one. 150, 150 plus. Kolo, Leon. Let me get in another one. 150.
I'm just the one to lock you out.
Yes, you're the one to lock me out.
You are starting gangsterism.
What? No.
I continue looking at interest rates with Elise Kruger, NKC African economist, Mamela Martin-Kinga from FMB. And we were having a great discussion before, because now everything is up in the air. It's no longer steady rates and then possibly a cut. So your outlook of possible scenarios for the year, Elise?
Well, we still believe steady rates for the rest of this year. And I remember the bank targeted the headline inflation number. So even if core remains sticky close to 6, which I think is probably a good scenario to look at, it will still not react to the core, I think, per se, in for instance, hiking rates. Remember, the headline CPI is the one that is really the target. So if we have seen the upper turning point, you know, for quarter four, 2016, first quarter this year, you know, by the time we meet again in March, the upper end could be behind us. And, you know, I don't think they will be forward-looking and high, given something that happened in the last month. So we don't see any option for a hike. If it wasn't today, it's not going to happen, I think, in the next while, unless there's some serious wild card that we don't discuss here today. I think, yeah, at least for 18 months we see it flat. You know, I think the bar, as Lisita in the past has said, the bar for dropping rates is quite high. Mm. I think they would like to see headline inflation closer to the midpoint of the target band, i.e. around about, you know, 4.5, or say at least around about 5 and lower. And at this point in time, you know, forecasts suggest that that is still a way out. You know, mm-hmm. we could possibly look at that into 2018 if things, you know, really is favorable for the rand and for oil and, you know, and growth is picking up. Number of factors, but I can't see that right now.
So you're both suggesting that a cut definitely could be elusive for a while. And, you know, I'm interested in what you think about the actual power of a rate cut. Because we always say, you know, the Reserve Bank must look at the economy, must look at growth. But we had incredible low rates with no commensurate growth. So how effective would it be anyway?
Yeah, I think we need to be realistic about that bit. And I think a lot of people do say or do believe that an interest rate cut will be positive for the economy, probably in the short term. But I think what we need right now is for business confidence to increase. And once we see that, we'll see private investment increase, then we'll see GDP growth and job creation. And that's what the economy needs right now. Mm. I don't think that the solution to a weak economy is a cut in interest rates.
I was just thinking now, though, there's so many people in debt. Should we consider them as well?
Yes, and South Africans are quite heavily indebted, you know, so a 25 basis point cut in rates, you know, would help you on the margin. It will just offset maybe the higher tax you're going to pay after the Fed budget, but it won't, you know, really jumpstart this economy. You will have to have, you know, a couple of consecutive drops in interest rates to really, you know, maybe help more meaningful. But I think, as Mamalelo said, you know, the impact is on confidence. We are having a confidence crisis in South Africa for the past probably 2-3 years. We, you know, both consumer confidence are very low. I mean, we've got tiny pickups next month just to see another drop. So we are just muddling along at very low confidence levels for both consumers and for businesses. And, you know, a number of factors obviously impacting on that, both on the economic side, the job market, maybe the political uncertainties and ramifications. One can chat about that for a long time, but, you know, we need confidence. Once you're confident, you'll start spend. Mm. You know, you buy a new car. If you're not confident, you're going to, delay that purchase and try and, you know, make a plan for maybe next year, you know, because you're not confident about job market, about growth, about your financial position. So we seriously need in South Africa a confidence booster. And, you know, maybe a drop in rates could just be a starting point, but at this point in time, I don't think it's on the horizon.
But not enough. So more in the realm of politicians than the Reserve Bank itself. You were talking about core inflation and what you're seeing there. And I'd like to know from both of you, what's going on with food prices? You know, we have the rain, the drought seems to be over or about to be declared over. So when does that kick in? Because we know that food price inflation has been off the charts.
100%. I think the tricky thing here is last year we saw elevated grain prices. And what we're expecting this year is for grain prices, vegetable and food prices to steadily decline. But at the same time, you have meat prices that are expected to start increasing, peaking later on this year, if not into 2018. And last year we saw meat prices that were quite low, and this is because of the drought. Essentially what happened, farmers had to cull their cattle because they couldn't afford to keep them alive, and then that brought down meat prices, right? So now they need to rebuild stock, and my understanding of that process is that it takes about 12 to 24 months to rebuild stock. And in that period, what that essentially means is that supply of meat is low and meat prices are going to react to the lack of supply. So essentially you have a significant portion of the food inflation basket showing signs of improvement, but meat, which also holds a heavy weight, is increasing, meaning that the deceleration in food prices that we had thought we'd see at the beginning of last year is not going to be as fast as we had thought.
Your thoughts on this inflation basket at the moment?
I agree with her on the whole food price story. I think that's true, and also the leads and lags involved. Now, remember, we have seen the rains now, and a lot of that's still in the last month or two. Now we still need to see the maize growing, and, you know, we need to actually have the harvesting happening, and then only really second half of this year we could start to really see some impact. So that's on the food side. So I agree also with the bank saying, you know, food prices will come down slightly slower than, you know, anticipated. Actually, I was surprised at how high they do see it. So, but yeah, that indicates to me as well that they also see these trends, you know, that it's not going to be a this, you know, immediate down to deflation, which I think some market participants obviously do expect. But yes, overall for the basket, I mean, we are going to get the new weights on Friday. If you think about the spending period where they checked household spending patterns, you know, I doubt whether it's going to be a significant change compared to the previous time. Previous time it was just after the global financial crisis. You know, we were more in a recessionary mode with, you know, food spending being quite a bit higher. I think this period was a bit more stable in the economy. So we expect a very marginal impact, you know, sort of neutral impact on the overall inflation picture as a result of changing weights and rebasing.
Thank you very much, Elise Kruger and Mamela Matengi. Thank you for joining us from FNB and NKC African Economists. And that is a wrap. So no change. And according to our analysts today, we don't expect any fireworks from the Reserve Bank for this year. But you never know. That's a wrap. I'll be back with you at 6 o'clock. Till then.
One of the key things that you have there is preservation of the teeth, so that when you can function, you can chew your food. And if they are not taken care of properly, you can lose them.
The most common infection in the mouth is on the tooth,
right.
And it's dental caries or tooth decay.
That prolonged contact of the sugary substance, being juice or whatever, was in contact with the teeth for a long time. That's what causes the children to have what you see as rotten teeth.
We have a method that has been developed at Wits, which is called Appropriatech, which allows the person to have dentures delivered in a very quick and simple manner.
Join Health Talk every Saturday for all your health news.
The causes of depression in men is essentially the same as in women. And when we look overall at the causes of depression, it's really a multifactorial kind of thing. It's nothing one thing that really causes depression. And if one goes back into one's genetics, into your family history, there's often a genetic component to it, where you find that if there has been a family member, a mother or a father that has had depression, that there's a higher chance that one of the children will have depression. Then also there are the kind of circumstantial things that can cause depression. At any period of stress, and I mean, I suppose more specifically in men, we often see financial stress, we see work stress, that are the kind of stressors that provide significant stress over a period of time that can trigger a thing. But ultimately, depression is a biochemical, is a medical illness. And there are certain chemicals in the brain. For instance, the main ones that has got to do with regulating mood or how people feel is that of serotonin, perhaps noradrenaline, and perhaps even dopamine, the three that might take play a role in causing depression. And it's often those three things or those chemicals that concentration becomes abnormal, and that is why you need antidepressants to restore the balance and to restore those chemicals in your brain and to help you regulate your mood on a more normal level. Men always have egos, and they always feel that if they need to go for help, especially if it's psychiatric, psychological help, that this is often a sign of weakness. But again, you know, one needs to explain to men that depression is a mental, is a biological illness, and that it needs help and it needs to be treated from a medical point of view. And often once they understand that it's a medical thing, it kind of makes them more at ease, they're more inclined to come for help and take their medication. But I think the stigma, and unfortunately we've still got lots of stigma in our society these days, works against, you know, men coming forward to get help.
A presumed U.S. drone strike in the south of the country has killed three al-Qaeda suspects.
Death toll in Yemen's 18-month-old civil war now stands at about 10,000.
people get killed or die and are actually buried before they're recorded. And we don't have a way of recording that, but we know the numbers are much higher.
Water restrictions are to be imposed on villages in and around the Nkomazi municipality.
Pumps can't pump the water because there's no water in the river. And if the water is coming back, then it's full of mud.
Those who can pray and those who can do any miracle to make sure that we've got enough rain, give it a try.